Our area's most beautiful properties deserve the finest realtors. Meeks Realty Group. We focus on buying and selling residential and commercial properties throughout the tri-state area. Contact Meeks Realty Group online at meeks.us or call 304-440-1101.
The views and opinions expressed on this program do not necessarily reflect the views and opinions of 580 WCHS, its employees, or WVRC Media. From the studios of WVRC Media, the country, the United States of America, the state, West Virginia, the city, Charleston. This is the Dave Allen Show on 580 Live. And your host.
What we've got here is failure to communicate.
He's kind of a big deal.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass, and I'm all out of bubblegum.
Dave Allen.
And a good Tuesday morning to you. Welcome to the show. Hollywood Jeff Petty making his return as the producer today. Biggly Piggly Wiggly Hotline 304-345-5858. Fruit Pharmacy text 304-935-5008. The Dave Allen Show on 580 Live, brought to you by Thornhill Auto Group, including Thornhill GM Superstore. Looking for a powerful, luxurious, and innovative truck? Come check out the 2024 Silverado 1500 Crew Cab LTZ and High Country today. Find new roads to Thornhill GM Superstore. Click or come by Thornhill GM Superstore.com or on the road to total savings at Thornhill Motor Mile, US 119 in Chapmanville. And we come to you from the Parmar Store studio. If there's not a Parmar Store near you now, there will be soon. Parmar welcomes everyone into town for the 2024 State Boys Basketball Tournament this week at the Coliseum and Convention Center. Parmar, the official store of high school sports in West Virginia and of Marshall University. If there's not a Parmar Store near you now, there will be soon. We've got lots to get to this morning. Republican operative Rob Cornelius is going to join us a little bit later on in the show. Also, John Lamoni, who's a candidate for magistrate in Kanawha County. We're going to spend some time talking to him coming up a little bit later on. Also, a gentleman by the name of Pete Forsella. He is an author, and he's an expert on whistleblowing in the government. He's standing by. He's got a new book out, and he's actually in Charleston to kind of promote that and to do some public speaking. We'll talk to him coming up a little bit later. But I want to start off in the newsroom this morning. Chris Lawrence is here. Chris, good morning.
Good morning.
I want to start off with this couple of just horrific stories yesterday. One started in Lewis County and then ended in Kanawha County.
Yeah, it was a little bit after midnight on Monday morning. The volunteer fire department in Lewis County got a call at a remote location near Ireland, West Virginia. So remote they didn't even have cell service there. So when they got there, there was a house on fire. They realized they had at least one victim that was killed in the fire, and as they got into the building, they realized they had multiple victims, and now they have confirmed four people were killed in that fire. They were continuing their investigation. They found out a guy who lives in that area by the name of Luke Wilson, age 45. He's from Walkersville, which is not far from that particular location, that he had family in Hughes Creek here in Kanawha County. So about 4:30 in the morning, they asked the Kanawha County Sheriff's Department to go there just on a hunch and see if perhaps he had gone to their to his family's location there. According to Chief Deputy Joe Crawford, when deputies rolled up on the scene there at Hughes Creek, this Wilson was in the vehicle that they were looking for, and as they got out and approached the vehicle, he shot himself and killed himself there in the car. So you have four dead up there in Lewis County, and then the man who took his own life here in Kanawha County. Both incidents are apparently tied to one another. The fire is suspicious. They continue their investigation and are yet to release any names or ages on the victims in that fire in Lewis County. So that that continues to be under investigation with the state fire marshal's office this morning.
And then the other tragic story happened yesterday on the turnpike around 2 o'clock yesterday afternoon.
Yeah, that was at the Gent Toll Plaza, which is down in Raleigh County, northbound traffic. A car was coming up through there, and you know how it is when you get those toll plazas. I mean, that things start to back up, and everybody's trying to figure out which lane you're going to get in to get through the quickest. Apparently, this car did not even slow down. There were two cars stopped in the right lane of the toll plaza to pay their toll, and that car just full speed barreled right into both of them. The whole thing exploded, and three people were killed in the ensuing fire from that accident, and it blocked traffic on the turnpike northbound for hours yesterday afternoon. Of course, it's reopened this morning, but three people killed in that. They have not released the names in that either. The State Police Accident Reconstruction Team has put together their investigation, and they continue to work on that this morning. Still no names on that on those fatalities either this morning.
All right, Chris. We'll be listening, following along on the website and on the air. I appreciate you taking time to be here, man. Thanks
sure
a lot.
Thing, man.
Chris Lawrence from the newsroom. The Dave Allen Show on 580 Live is brought to you in part by Bridge Valley. If you're interested in improving your company's IT workforce, you may want to know Bridge Valley offers custom-tailored IT training to bridge the skills gap. At Bridge Valley, you can train for little or no cost with a 50-50 salary match. Bridge Valley can also supply skilled graduates and apprenticeships for your company. Visit bridgevalley.edu/apprenticeships today. All right, I want to spend some time talking about whistleblowers. Now, you hear about them all the time in the corporate world, but maybe not as much as we should in the world of politics and government, but it does happen. Pete Forselli was one of the main whistleblowers with Operation Fast and Furious, and he's in Charleston. He's in our studio today. He also has a new book coming out. We'll get into that. Pete, good morning and welcome to the show.
Good morning, Dave. Honored to be here.
Thank you for taking time out of your schedule to be here. First of all, let's review. What was Operation Fast and Furious?
Operation Fast and Furious was a case that was run out of ATF's Phoenix Field Division, and it was a case in which the agents that were working the investigation allowed guns to cross the border into Mexico, and many Mexican citizens were killed. And then in December of 2010, a Border Patrol agent named Brian Terry was killed with a gun that was trafficked as part of that investigation. And that led to John Dodson, who was an agent in that group, coming forward and speaking to Senator Grassley's office. And then that led to the U.S. Attorney's Office in Phoenix contemplating indicting John Dodson. So I stepped forward because for many years before that, we were trying to get actual firearms traffickers indicted by the U.S. Attorney's Office, and they wouldn't take action. And I was somewhat appalled that, hey, all of these firearms traffickers you let walk, now you're talking about indicting a federal agent who stepped up and did the right thing and blew the whistle on something in his group. It was appalling to me.
What was it that led you to make that leap to do that? You said that you'd wanted to do it for some time, but what was it that finally said, okay, we've got to step up?
Well, the gun dealers in Phoenix were cooperative. They worked with us. They would tell us about suspicious purchases happening that they knew were being trafficked to Mexico. We would invariably stop the cars, get confessions, refer those individuals for prosecution because they were supplying guns to people who were butchering other humans south of the border. And we would invariably be told, hey, let them go. We'll indict it later. And those indictments would rarely ever come. So when they were talking about indicting an agent for stepping forward and blowing the whistle on what was happening in the group that was letting guns actually walk to the border, because we stopped guns with the assistance of those dealers, but no one was getting charged. So here, conversely, this group was letting the guns walk into Mexico, and the thought that they were an agent while they gave all of those firearms traffickers a pass was, to me, a bridge too far.
Give the listeners some of your background and as far as like your background and how you got involved in all this.
Sure. I started as a cop in New York. Yeah. I walked the beat, you know, the old school way. Got to know the community, built their trust, became a detective. Same thing, that trust you built with the community helped solve cases. The Bronx criminal justice system was pretty bad. Nobody spent time in jail. My last murder case was a 4-year-old kid that got beat to death by his stepfather. And after trial, he was sentenced to 4 years in prison. So I started working gun cases to flip defendants and have them proffer and go after people involved in more serious crime. So we did racketeering cases, continuing criminal enterprise cases. So I left being a detective in the NYPD to join ATF because, you know, I was doing it with the permission of the NYPD. Mm-hmm. Going to ATF, I'd be a federal agent. I could do it all the time. So I was an agent in New York for about 6 years, went out to Phoenix, and that's where I saw things were vastly different than they were in New York.
How so? How were they different out there?
Well, in New York, the prosecutors actually prosecuted criminals, violent criminals. Mm-hmm. And in Phoenix, what I saw was they weren't prosecuting people who were, like, again, trafficking guns to people who were butchering other humans, which was appalling. Because, look, hey, I get it. It's not our country. But what was happening in Mexico bothered me because I'd see the pictures that came across in intelligence bulletins. They're human beings. It wasn't just cartel people being killed. It was Mexican cops, Mexican citizens. So when I found out that they were letting guns walk into the country, and again, we didn't know in other groups in Phoenix what was happening in that group until Brian Terry died, it was appalling. It went against the grain of everything I raised my hand and took an oath to do. So again, when they went after John, that's when I stepped up. So then after Phoenix, I spent time in various other parts of the country, was the agent in charge of the Miami Field Division during the Parkland shooting and the Fort Lauderdale Airport mass shooting. So I had a good 35-year career with a bump in the road in the 5 years that I spent in Phoenix, because after blowing the whistle, I spent 4 years being retaliated against and having to defend my reputation while under investigation by DOJ attorneys and the inspector general and whatnot. But in the end, I prevailed because the truth is the truth. It's a powerful weapon.
I want to talk about that retaliation, Pete. Exactly what happened to you? Because in reading about this, you almost lost everything here.
Yes, correct. Right.
Talk about that retaliation.
Sure. Well, it started actually the day I was deposed by in front of Congress, in front of the staffers from Senator Grassley's office, Senator Leahy, Darrell Issa, who was the ranking member of the Oversight Committee, and Elijah Cummings. So what happened was literally before I walked out of that deposition room and made it back to my office, which was a 6-block walk, I received information that the U.S. attorney, who was the chief federal law enforcement officer in the state of Arizona, and who primarily his office is who I was blowing the whistle on, was made aware of everything I said. So before I walked 6 blocks, they had gotten a phone call and were told everything I said in that room. The following day, I got a call from another assistant U.S. attorney who showed me an email that was sent out by the U.S. attorney saying, anyone having contact with Pete Fraselli, even if it's witnessing him and his family having coffee on a weekend, is to be reported to me through your chain of command immediately. And it just got worse. When I actually testified in front of the actual committee, the chief of the criminal division accused me of perjury. And then when he was subpoenaed to come in and testify about what he was involved in, he pled the fifth and resigned. So it goes to show you how much integrity he had. So when it just continued for there, I spent 4 years under investigation, became the U.S. attorney's offices were saying one thing, which was in conflict with what I was saying. So 6 different times during that investigation, I said, hey, if you don't believe me, polygraph me. Mm-hmm. And each time they were like, well, that's not really necessary. We believe you. But yet their investigation mm-hmm. continued. But in the end...
And you're over here like, yeah, no, do this.
Correct.
Polygraph me.
Correct, which is risky to do because, I mean, a polygraph isn't the most accurate
sure,
tool. And if
absolutely.
You fail one, they're going to revoke your clearance. But I was very blessed because I had some support from within the agency and I had some support from staffers from Senator Grassley's office because, look, his passion is whistleblowing. And, you know, look, all four staffs said, hey, when they come after you, if they come after you, call us. Leahy's office wouldn't answer the phone. Cummings had some nice things to say, but didn't engage. ISIS people said, hey, we're tracking it. But Senator Grassley's staff, without fail, every time I needed help, they were there. And that's one of the reasons why I'm here in town is because Tristan Leavitt, who was one of Senator Grassley's staffers, mm-hmm. who's running for office here locally, was one of those people who had my back when I was getting my teeth kicked in. So I kept my word, but it's important for folks to know he kept his word. Mm-hmm. And I think that's partially why I still had a job. I retired in October of 2021. Mm-hmm. I retired as the head of training for ATF. So I made it, you know, I recovered my career, but it was through the help of other people and
right.
and not being willing to let people take my reputation from me.
We have a text here, and it says, does the guest know that U.S. guns are still going to Mexico, U.S., as well as other criminal organizations, and is this still a concern?
It is, and it's ironic, because the Phoenix U.S. Attorney's Office, I'm told, because I still stay in touch with folks, mm-hmm. is still the worst U.S. Attorney's Office in the country when it comes to dealing with the problem. Look, for the Sinaloa cartel, Arizona was its gun store. I mean, look, they also get guns stolen from Mexican police, from Mexican military, from all over the planet, frankly, because, I mean, the Sinaloa cartel is now a global conglomerate. We have an endless budget. But a lot of the guns are straw purchased in the United States, primarily Arizona for the Sinaloans. They're smuggled in and then they're converted in many instances to machine guns down there and used against Mexican military and police.
So it's Pete, it's book plug time. Now, you have all this laid out in a new book from Simon & Schuster and Knox Press called The Deadly Path. Tell us about the book.
Sure. The book is called The Deadly Path, How Operation Fast and Furious and Bad Lawyers Armed Mexican Cartels is the subtitle. And it outlines what happened because during the scandal, there was a lot of political finger pointing. The Operation Fast and Furious started in under the Obama administration. But to muddy the waters, there was people saying, well, it actually started under George Bush and blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. The reality is that's not what happened. The group that ran that case wasn't even formed until October of 2009, which the federal fiscal year is October to October. So, and Brian Terry was killed shortly after. And then Fast and Furious ended, the program itself ended when the scandal hit and when they made some arrests. So, I mean, I just wanted to clarify some of the points that were very muddy back then. Because, look, there were agents in other parts of the United States who had no idea what was going on. And they would approach us and say, hey, you know, what happened? So we even proposed, let's have an after action report like they do in the military mm-hmm. so people could learn from it. And the DOJ lawyers were always like, no, we don't talk about it. So I'm a firm believer that if you don't no history, you're bound to repeat it. So I wanted to set the record straight for the American public, but also for employees of ATF and for new people coming on board with ATF, which has a noble mission when it's done right, just to clarify the record.
And you were in Charleston at a speaking engagement. You had one, I think, last night. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. So so what's life like for you now, Pete? I mean, you got the book and you're out plugging the book. You're doing speaking engagement. What's life like for Pete Frisell now?
It's good. I did write the book. It took a while to get it out. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I'd never realized I'm not a writer by trade, so right. I didn't realize how difficult the publishing industry is. Yeah. But I also speak at the 9/11 Memorial and Museum about resilience. I'm a lung cancer survivor. I was a 9/11 first responder, wound up getting lung cancer many years later, lost the right lung. Very lucky, no chemo, no radiation. I'm cancer free for 6 years now. I speak to law enforcement executives and as a coach. And I also speak to law enforcement organizations about leadership and resilience. And it's funny because a lot of folks actually find leadership lessons in the what I went through with Fast and Furious, and even in the book itself. So I'm hoping that'll turn into something productive so that I can, you know, have folks learn from the mistakes that were made by ATF folks working in Phoenix at that time. Again, you know, just so that folks don't repeat something like that.
Well, and we actually have a text about that. Someone said, how can you prevent the straw purchases?
Well, look, straw purchases, what a lot of people don't, a lot of people want to blame the gun industry. The gun industry, the dealers used to call us when straw purchases were happening that were obvious. The problem is straw purchasing is an act of deception where people who can lawfully buy a firearm, who can pass a background check, go in and buy a firearm for somebody else. In Arizona, more often than not, it was for cartel people who were trafficking to cartels. But I mean, the dealers were trained by the National Shooting Sports Foundation and ATF and what to look for. But the problem is if they don't exhibit those signs, like taking pictures of the firearms and then texting them to someone who might be waiting in a parking lot, mm-hmm. or having someone come in and point out guns, and then that person would leave, and then this person would say that they were for them when it was clear that someone else picked out the guns. In those instances, the dealers would call us. We would stop the cars, ask probative questions, seize the guns. And in Arizona, very few people went to prison for doing it. But we would have those guns in our custody that would never be pointed at some cop or some kid or some old lady. I mean, so we took some pride in that. But there are instances where if the straw purchaser doesn't exhibit any signs, the dealers, they don't have ESP. They can't tell. Yeah. So in those instances, we find out about it when the gun is recovered somewhere. And how you prevent it is by prosecuting the people that do it. When you have situations like what we had in Arizona, where 90%+ of our cases are presented to U.S. Attorney's Office and they pass, then that person can continue to buy guns because they don't have a criminal history. So, and I get it. It's unfortunate because most straw purchasers are people who are down on their luck, you know, single moms, people who are sick, people who need money. But, you know, the end result, yeah, they might only get $100 to buy a gun that they're handed off to some cartel guy. But the carnage that's happening in Mexico, and look, some of these guns are being used in the United States, warrants that they be prosecuted. And here's the other thing. These aren't loaves of bread. They're not apples. They're not oranges. They don't biodegrade. They don't rot. They'll stay out there in the hands of evil people until they're recovered at a crime scene. And look, the Fast and Furious guns are still turning up next to dead bodies.
It's amazing. Give us final 30 seconds. Give me the title of the book and so on and so forth. It's out from Simon & Schuster and Knox Press. It's called
The Deadly Path.
Yeah.
How Operation Fast and Furious and Bad Lawyers Armed the Mexican Cartels. It's on Amazon. It's on stores and bookshelves. People can find it very easily now.
All right, Pete. Fascinating story. And I appreciate you taking time out of your schedule to be here to tell us about it.
Honored to be here. Thanks for having me.
All right, Pete Frisell. Hang out with me 1 second. It's 9:25. The Dave Allen Show on 580 Live, brought to you by Pinnacle Consultants, the only accredited commercial lab in the state for asbestos and mold. Asbestos was banned in some building products, but not banned for all products in the U.S. Do not expose your family or workers to asbestos, mold, or lead paint. Get with Pinnacle Consultants. They offer real estate environmental assessments for hazardous materials and air quality. Visit PinnacleCorp.net, because what you don't know can hurt you. Hollywood Jeff Petty is our producer today. We are going to take a break. When we come back, John Luoni, who's a candidate for magistrate here in Kanawha County, is going to join us back after this from the Parmar Store Studio and the Voice of Charleston, WCHS.
Brought to you by the Eric J. Tarr Family Businesses. Eric J. Tarr Family Businesses are small businesses with big impact, including Generations Physical Therapy and Snap Fitness.
Hi, I'm David McCormick, owner of Omega Commercial Interiors. We'd like to thank you, West Virginia, for making us the number one office furniture and commercial interiors company in West Virginia. Remember, when you're looking for quality office furniture and space planning for healthcare, corporate offices, or even a private office, call us and buy local. Omega Commercial Interiors. We're a proud West Virginia company. Visit us online at OmegaCommercialInteriors.com in Morgantown and Charleston.
Are you looking for a powerful, luxurious, and innovative truck? Hey, it's Sydney, inviting you to find new roads with Thornhill and check out the new 2024 Chevrolet Silverado 1500 Crew Cab LTZ and High Country at Thornhill GM Superstore on the Thornhill Motor Mile. Right now, you can get 1.9% APR for well-qualified buyers or $5,000 total value when you trade in an eligible vehicle. It's an opportunity to save big on the new Chevy truck that'll haul the winter blues away. Find new roads to Thornhill GM Superstore. Click or come by at ThornhillGMSuperstore.com or on the road to total savings. US 119 Chapmanville. All offers through GM Financial. See Thornhill for all details.
Thrive with Five at the best community bank in the Kanawha Valley, Poca Valley Bank. Poca Valley Bank is now offering a certificate of deposit special, 10-month APY, annual percentage yield 5%. Take advantage of this great rate to grow your savings. For more information, stop by a Poca Valley Bank location today or call 844-782-2651. Poca Valley Bank, where relationships matter. Certain terms and conditions apply. Rates based on minimum annual percentage yield, subject to change without notice. Minimum deposit required of $10,000 of new money not currently on deposit with Poca Valley Bank to receive APY. Member FDIC.
Career politicians in Charleston and Washington are taxing our families too much. Let's vote for a Republican that will fight for us. Republican Dwayne Duncan, running for Kanawha County Commission, wants to cut taxes for all our families. Dwayne Duncan wants more jobs, lower taxes, and safer communities. Dwayne Duncan is a job creator and believes you should keep more of your hard-earned money. Let's vote for lower taxes and more jobs. Let's vote for Republican Dwayne Duncan for Kanawha County Commission.
Paid for by Dwayne Duncan for County Commission. Tori DeCubo, Treasurer.
.928 Special Olympics embodies the true spirit of sportsmanship. It's not merely about winning medals. It's about being a part of a team, practicing and competing together. The joy and fulfillment derived from these experiences are immeasurable as athletes find their confidence and self-worth through the shared pursuit of victory. West Virginia Enriched, in collaboration with Huntington, invites you to witness the transformative power of Special Olympics. See a video highlighting the Special Olympics at facebook.com/580WCHS. So the Dave Allen Show on 580 Live is brought to you in part by General Hardware of Winfield and Milton. And also General Lumber of Winfield. Whether you are getting your home ready for warm weather months or you have a project you're about to get underway, they can help. Locally owned and operated, General Hardware and Lumber. Visit GeneralHardwareWV.com. Tech says to the guests, God bless you and thank you for everything on that day. And do you feel, unfortunately he's not here right now, do you feel the same way I do, that as insanely evil as our country and government have become, if 9/11 happened today, there would be no 9/12 tomorrow, says a texter. As I mentioned earlier, day one for the boys' state's basketball tournament over at the Coliseum Convention Center as we speak. Matchup between the 3-seed Nitro Wildcats and the 6-seed Indians of Sissonville. That game getting underway right about now. All the action now, WVMetroNews.com and on Charleston's ESPN Radio, 106.7 FM, 1490 AM. The daytime games, in addition, are on the website. You can listen in there. The evening sessions are on the WCHS network of stations. And I will mention the second game today also has Kanawha Valley teams in it. It's quad A battle, at least one team between South Charleston, number 5 seed, and the Black Eagles of the Black Eagles are taking on 4th seed Jefferson. Quick plug, you know I'm going to do it for my alma mater, the Logan Wildcats. I've got my gold and blue on today. Logan is a 5 seed in AAA. They have the final game of the Tuesday session. They'll take on 4th seed at East Fairmont. That game's slated for 9 o'clock tonight. You know I'm going to get a little love in for my alma mater. Candidate for Kanawha County Manager John Leone is here. John, good morning. Welcome to the show.
Thanks, Dave. Glad to be here.
Give us a bio on John Leone. You certainly are no stranger to the political scene here in the Valley, but tell us about John Leone.
Well, John Leone, I'm an engineer. I've worked at DuPont in carbide for many years. The last 17 years I worked, I was the county engineer for the Kanawha County Commission. And I just have an interest in one of the reasons I decided to run for magistrate is that I feel like I have a lot of the qualifications that make for an excellent magistrate. And with the 3 new positions that Kanawha County's adding, I thought I'd throw my hat in the ring and give it a shot.
What do you see as the biggest needs of the magistrate's office here? And what will you do differently if elected?
Well, one of the things that I plan to do is I want to use common sense. I think that that's an important characteristic of a magistrate. I have a high level of respect for law and order. I've been endorsed by the Capital City Fraternal of Police, which I think is I'm very honored to receive that endorsement. One of the reasons I think I'm qualified is I've actually helped develop several county ordinances, particularly one that I worked a lot on was the meth lab decontamination ordinance to make sure that the levels of contaminants following a cleanup are low enough so that people can't be exposed to toxic or carcinogenic materials that are left in the pores of the walls or ceilings or floors. I think that gives me an up. I've been in magistrate court defending some of the county ordinances where I had to give testimony, show lab results, photo evidence, et cetera. So I've had experience in that arena, and I feel like I have a lot of the qualifications that people need look for. And one of the things that magistrate is, you're an important link in the public safety and justice system. And I think it's important that people have confidence that when they come before a magistrate, that they're going to be listened to. And one of the, I think I also have the skill in being able to determine truth from fiction. A lot of times you'll get testimony and you have to sort it out. And I think I have the skills to be able to do that.
And it's a nonpartisan position, but can I ask you what your political party is?
Yes. I'm Republican.
Republican, okay. And, you know, John, I talk about this with nearly every candidate I have on that's running for an office like a magistrate or a judge or sheriff or whatever. The overwhelming majority of crimes, most would say upwards, if not of 90% or greater, have drugs somewhere at the root of it, whether it's stolen property, domestic violence, assaults, shootings, you name it. No one knows how to fix it, but what will you do or attempt to do if elected?
Well, one of the things I want to do is make sure that criminals, if they come before me, they're not given a low enough bond that they can easily make it. I was told by one of the police chiefs that there was a case where a gentleman was fishing without a license, and because he didn't make bail, he ended up in prison for 6 or 7 weeks. Whereas we've got drug dealers, they can make bail, they're back out. Some violent criminals can make bail, they're back out on the streets. And we had this person that was fishing without a license occupying a jail cell. That's the kind of thing that I think we need to relook at, and let's make sure that the criminals who are the biggest threat to public safety are kept away from the general public. And I think that's something as a magistrate that I'm committed to do to help protect the public and make sure I do my part as a key component of the public safety system to keep those people that are a threat to society out of the public when they're brought before my court, make sure they don't come back out. They don't have an easy path to get back out into society.
What's your campaign strategy look like? You know, social media? I know you're definitely out and about. I see your pictures all the time. You're always out somewhere in the public. What's your campaign strategy for John Lawoney look like?
Going to public events, meeting people. I try to, like, I'm going to the Marshall WVU baseball game tonight.
And cheering for the Herd like you should? I'm kidding, John.
Yeah, well, I'll cheer for both
go
teams.
Go teams. Go both teams.
Yeah, I want to.
I'm just messing with you, John. Exactly. Go teams. Go teams.
Yes, but, go both but, teams. Exactly.
But that sort of thing. So that's what you're out doing, right?
Right. No, meeting people. I went to Symphony Saturday night, went to Mountain Stage Sunday night. So I'm out and about going to different events and meeting people. I think that's one of the best ways to get your message out. I have a Facebook page, mm-hmm. John Lawoney for Magistrate. I think you've probably seen it, mm-hmm. Dave.
Yeah.
So, and those are the things that I'm doing.
Give me the final 30. Why should someone vote for John Lawoney for Kanawha County Magistrate?
All right. I think I have a lot of the qualities that voters need to look for in a good magistrate. I have common sense. I'm a good listener. I can judge testimony, in my opinion, about whether it's truth or fiction. I have a high level of respect for law and order. As I mentioned, I was endorsed by the Capital City Fraternal Police. I'm somebody that has developed some of the ordinances, such as the meth lab decontamination ordinance, that is there to help protect the public. And I think they want somebody in there that they have confidence in that can do the job and understands their role is the public safety and justice system, and to protect the public, as I say, from violent criminals and drug dealers, et cetera.
John Luoni, candidate for magistrate in Kanawha County. John, always wish you the best of luck. Great to see you, my friend, and good luck on the campaign trail.
All right. Thanks, Dave.
All right. Thank you a lot. The Dave Allen Show on 580 Live, brought to you in part by Meeks Realty Group. Discover the unrivaled expertise of Meeks, your ultimate partners in all things real estate, whether it's your dream home or that ideal commercial space. Meeks has you covered. Contact Rich, the realtor, 304-932-7488. Let Rich and the team guide you on your real estate journey. Take a look at all their listings at Meeks.us. Biggly Piggly Wiggly Hotline, 304-345-5858. Fruit Pharmacy, text 304-935-5008. Back after this on The Voice of Charleston, WCHS.
Brought to you by the Eric J. Tarr Family Businesses. Eric J. Tarr Family Businesses bring first-class businesses to your community.
Are you looking for a powerful, luxurious, and innovative truck? Hey, it's Sydney inviting you to find new roads with Thornhill and check out the new 2024 Chevrolet Silverado 1500 Crew Cab LTZ and High Country at Thornhill GM Superstore on the Thornhill Motor Mile. Right now, you can get 1.9% APR for well-qualified buyers or $5,000 total value when you trade in an eligible vehicle. It's an opportunity to save big on the new Chevy truck that'll haul the winter blues away. Find new roads to Thornhill GM Superstore. Click or come by at thornhillgmsuperstore.com. We're on the road to total savings. US 119 Chapmanville. All offers through GM Financial. See Thornhill for all details.
For too long, liberal activist judges have been in power. All while we're losing jobs, criminals go free, and the drug problem gets worse. It's time for a fresh face in the courthouse.
I'm Ashley Deem, a lifelong Republican running in the nonpartisan race for Kanawha County Circuit Judge. Born and raised in Kanawha County, I understand the challenges our families face.
Ashley Deem is a conservative who will be tough on crime and apply the law fairly. Vote for Ashley Deem for Circuit Judge. Paid for by the committee to elect Ashley Deem for judge.
Biggly Piggly Wiggly on Spring Street has served three generations of shoppers since 1955 as the largest locally owned independent grocery store in the area. The Joseph family owners grew up here, so you know they're invested in the community. They provide the biggest variety of choice meats, the freshest produce, an in-house deli bakery, great wine selection, and more of your favorite brands. Every purchase gives you gasoline points so you can save at our pumps. Order online for pickup at BiglyPigglyWiggly.com. Biggly Piggly Wiggly on Spring Street. No one beats the pig.
Spring is right around the corner, and Walker Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram and Hurricane is ready to help you upgrade your ride just in time for the change in seasons. Walker has some big-time savings going on this month to help you get ready for the warmer weather. Check out Jeep Gladiators with up to $14,000 off MSRP. Walker also has the largest selection around of the Jeep Grand Cherokees you can't find anywhere. Not to mention Ram trucks are stocked deep and ready to move with up to $10,000 off new 1500 crew cabs. And just when you thought the deals couldn't get any sweeter, Gene and Ryan loaded down the pre-owned lot and then marked them all down. Not only are there great prices, but it's a huge selection you'll find at Walker, including Toyotas, Hondas, Chevys, Fords, and anything else you could possibly want. And don't forget, Walker is still buying cars too. So as spring approaches, take that short 20-minute drive from Charleston or Huntington for the best deals around at Walker Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram. Just off the Hurricane exit of I-60. Walker Chrysler Dodge Jeep Ram, making friends one deal at a time.
20 minutes away from 10, the Dave Allen Show and 580 Live, brought to you part by Hudson's Pizza. Get an 18-inch pepperoni pizza and a pizza bowl, only $22.99. Find your nearest Hudson's Pizza at hudsonspizza.com for delivery, pickup, or for dine-in. Biggly Piggly Wiggly Hotline, 304-345-5858. Fruit Pharmacy text, 304-935-5008. Now there's another way to enjoy your favorite Metro-News programs like Talk Line, Sports Line, Three Guys Before the Game, and more. Instead of just listening, you could watch The Voice of West Virginia. Check out the new WV Metro News TV app. Simply download it to your favorite device from Apple TV, iOS, Android, Roku, Amazon, and more. Download the Metro News TV app to enjoy all your favorite Metro News personalities from Caridi to Kercheval and more. It's Metro News for your ears and now your eyes too. Download the free Metro News TV app at wvmetronews.com. My next guest, he never met a microphone he didn't like.
I love them all.
And I mean that in the best possible way. The always popular, always entertaining, Rob Cornelius.
Hey, man. Glad to be here. Good to see you.
Rob texted me this morning. He's the only one that I know that maybe other than maybe Adam Harris, my good friend from Mountain Stage, or maybe my producer, Hollywood Jeff Petty.
Steve knew.
Steve knew that would ask for the theme to World Class Championship Wrestling as your walk-up music. Sorry I did not make that happen.
Yeah, with the satellite dish and the big time timpani, the big kettle drums, and the world-famous sportatorium.
You taking all this down, Hollywood? You're the wrestling. I actually had to look that up when you texted me that this morning, because I, you know, didn't get world class around here, but I had to go look it up.
But you've used it on the show at some point.
I use the World Championship Wrestling theme, and
you've used a bunch. Did you use like the retro version of Midnight Express's theme at some point?
I do, and I also use the theme to Starcade, which is Far From Over from Frank Stallone.
Right. I like looping that. That's fine. Right, go.
We could talk wrestling all day, and especially if I get Hollywood Jeff, who's the podcast host of
Wrestling. I've heard that. You're pushing the podcast right now.
Jeff, here's a great guest to talk old school wrestling right here. You need to meet Rob Cornelius after the show. All right. So outside the world of politics, you're also a noted sportscaster. Where's March Madness for you?
I am going to Cleveland. I have work duties starting tomorrow, and hopefully three games in Cleveland when the NCAA is on a charter someplace next week to learn about new geography and be in the 68.
All right. I want to talk about this past legislative session. What'd you think?
Bad mojo, bad aura over everybody. The two bodies don't get along very well at all.
Do you mean both
the Senate,
aspects
the Senate
of
the House?
Okay,
yeah, the Senate and the House.
You don't mean parties anymore?
No, because and I've said this, and people inside are saying this all the time. This may offend some, but it was easier to run both bodies, and both bodies were way more effective when the margins were thinner, when the House was 55-45, when the Senate was 18-60. Remember that one time when Daniel Hall had to flip and all that? If everybody has to be on the same page or stuff doesn't pass, everybody sticks together. The wolf pack stays together. But when you have a bunch of people and they can go wild and you have 9 or 10 votes you don't need, those people start stretching and start asking for things, and it becomes a real issue in terms of managing the body. I don't know what people want. Legislation should be more aggressive, less aggressive, whatever, but it's harder to manage a bigger pack.
Let's talk about the Republican Party and the supermajority and the super duper majority. Now I understand there is a super duper duper majority.
Well, I mean, when we're done in November, it's going to be 32-2 and 93-7, maybe. Mm-hmm. That's my guess. We're going to put them on the chalkboard in here, wherever.
Okay. But I mean, is this cause for concern within the Republican Party that there seems to be such divisions within the party?
Yeah, I think so. I think again, in terms of managing the state, but you know what? As I always tell you on this show, it's easy to run for stuff. It's fun to run for stuff and stake out positions. The business of actually going to that Capitol and governing and doing a good job for people who aren't political is hard. Mm-hmm. And guess what governing is? It's not sexy, and it's not fun.
Yeah.
And it's hard to do well, and nobody respects you when you do it well, because you're either not far enough right or not far enough left.
I agree. Dave Allen Show on 580 Live, brought to you part by Morgan & Morgan. If you're injured, hire Morgan & Morgan, America's largest injury law firm. Rob, I was told yesterday by a friend that I, Dave, should be happy with the session because a lot of the more social issues didn't get touched. I've been called a country club Republican or a chamber of that I, Dave, should be happy with the session because a lot of the more social issues didn't get touched. I've been called a country club Republican or a chamber of commerce Republican. I will own those.
Well, and that's fine because there are interests in business and the economy. At heart, the voter, the more middle of the road voter, the non-primary voter, their number one issue is still going to be jobs, economy, unemployment. But a primary voter who is at the very further right or further left string of their party in this primary is going to go toward more specific, harder right things. And the problem is you have to please them first. And if you don't, then everyone in your party is going to say you're not far enough right or far enough left. Mm-hmm. Period. Even the Dems. You even see the split among the Dems among people who are not left enough for them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Kayla Young is a great example. Mm-hmm. You know, people call her and tell her all the time she's not left enough. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're down to like 6 people or something over there.
I've heard that people say Pushkin's not left enough.
Well,
I've had people to this show that have texted me and said Mike Pushkin is not far left.
Yeah, enough. And the thing is, they are the loudest voices because they text, they call.
Well, it's the same on the Republican side.
And it works both ways. So you are dragged by what you think public opinion is, when public opinion is probably closer to the middle.
Rob Cornelius is here. Rob, I've gone back and forth in my head on how much or how little I wanted to cover this story, a story I first brought up last week.
You did, and that was courageous. I wasn't expecting you to pop that at the end of the show that day.
I get a little drink of courage every now and then. Not a drink. It wasn't a drink, I promise. So last Tuesday night of last week, my phone started blowing up with a fake news site.
Yep.
Supposedly out of Pittsburgh. Made to look like an actual newspaper, at least an online one, which it obviously wasn't. Anyone with half a brain, and trust me, I've been accused of having half a brain many, many times. Anyone could tell it was fake. Whomever put it together probably should have gotten a middle schooler to help him with it because it was that bad. However, it had to do with a candidate for governor, and the headline was something like, he could be West Virginia's first gay governor. Now, as I said, my phone started to blow up late Tuesday night and early Wednesday morning, and I did bring it up on the show Wednesday, I think it was, of last week. There's a lot, I don't want to get into this too deeply, but I do want to get your take on it, because there's a lot of finger pointing as to who is responsible for this. Now, I know that on Twitter, there is a guy who I've had my issues with in the past. There's a guy named Kyle Vass, who is closely associated with the ACLU. I don't know Kyle personally. He and I have battled a couple times on Twitter. Don't know him personally. But he has really uncovered a lot with this story. And at the risk of getting both of us sued, I'm not going to go too deeply into it. But overall, and I'll say this, I tend to want to concentrate on subjects that come from legitimate news sources,
yes,
not fake news sites. But overall, your view from 10,000 feet of this story?
It was a ham-handed attempt to tarnish or shame or otherwise hurt one of the candidates for governor in a very sloppy way. Website that had been created like a week before. And the stuff this guy on the internet found, the background anyway, is all pretty easily available. You know, you look at who his servers and whatnot and figure out who bought a website, when they bought it, whatever, all these things that happened. Look, here's the issue. It's been tied to some folks who are extremely hard right. This was clearly written an attempt to avoid being sued, but to like kind of just put something in the air. Oh, this person might be, you know, whatever. But on the flip side, you know, it's possibly tied to one or more of the other candidates, and that doesn't make sense. And I put it this way: this is a four-way governor's race on the Republican side, effectively. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Even if you're such a genius and you get this message out there and you tar and feather one of these other candidates with some unfounded or unprovable claim, you don't know where their votes are going to go. So tactically, this is very, very stupid. And the question is, what do you expect to happen? Other than just basically being the guy at the party that goes in the room where all the coats are and poops on the bed or whatever, poops on the coats, like just ruins it for everybody. Mm-hmm. You know, that is all this is. And it's not going to go anywhere. And the campaign to which, you know, that reporter is saying it's tied is the one that's very much in fourth place with a bullet and isn't going anywhere.
I've heard again, and I tried to dance around this thing like you wouldn't believe.
How about we just say every candidate in the race is accused of being gay? You are all gay. That's it. We're all disqualified. Ha ha! Great job, guys.
According to the Republican Party, that's probably what they would want, or at least a lot of members of the Republican Party. Of which, by the way, I'm still a member of the Republican Party.
Well, I mean, check with Peter Thiel. Check with some of the guys from Trump administration. Look. Gay people vote, and some gay people just want jobs and economy to be left alone. And I don't think anybody has a whole lot of beef with that.
I couldn't care less who sleeps with who, to be honest with you. I mean, that's just me. It's not, it ain't my fight. I don't care. You know, I go home to my wife. You go home to your wife. I couldn't care less.
My wife is terrifying, by the way, but in a good way.
I know your wife. She's been on this show.
She does a great job.
She's awesome.
Yeah.
You definitely overachieved. You know that?
By far. Outkicked it, 500-yard drive, whatever.
As did I.
Very much so.
Understand it. I do find it ironic, though, that, and you can't damn the whole party, you know, for this over what a couple of people may or may not have done. But
clowns.
I will say this.
Yeah.
You said clowns. I will say this. I find it very interesting, though, that the party of which I'm a member that screams fake news, fake news, fake news, goes out and invents a fake news site.
Well, again, party, that's, you know, whatever, however many 100,000 people there are
right.
on this site. You can't blame everyone for that.
Right. I said that. Yeah.
No. And again, it's fake news. People should be smarter. People should be able to discern these things. But it's clearly an attempt to do that. And the problem is it's coming from people that are desperate, frantic, and lying in terms of this campaign that don't have any shot. And this is, Christopher Plummer in Star Trek III just yelling at you from, you know, the doorway to hell or whatever.
All right,
They're done.
Let me knock out a couple of texts here. Text says, Dave, at least it was a right-wing person or group that came up with the fake website. Democrats didn't do it. Fade in the roaring applause, says the text.
Yeah, sure. People on both sides can make stupid fake decisions and lie in public. Now, the funny thing is, public figures are pretty much, as we know from all the Don Blankenship law going up to the federal, you can pretty much say anything you want about a public figure. Mm-hmm. That's pretty much what those cases have set out there for you. So this is not necessarily a problem. Two, I'm pretty sure there's a circuit out west that's actually said that calling someone gay is not defamatory. It's actually pretty cool. So again, that's not necessarily a libelous situation. Mm-hmm. Not an attorney, not legal advice.
Tech says, the sad part is the website creators and the other people of their mind think that being gay is something to be ashamed of.
That's your call personally. You can make that decision. That's between you and you and your pastor, you and Jesus, you and whomever. Allah, whatever.
Whoever. Tech says division just means there's debate, which is always a good thing as long as they don't become too obsessive.
I mean, that's just general. Part of this is just manners, a lot of it in this legislature. And that's kind of what people are dealing with, is just be good to each other, whatever Jerry Springer said. Being disagreeing without being disagreeable. And there's a lot of that, a lot of blood sport to no real great end. Again, much like this website, what exactly are you trying to accomplish? What exactly are you going to do? Explain to me the effect, what you're going to effectively do when that happens.
Well, I mean, and I had, as I said, and we'll go to break with this, Jeff, I've had people that sent me that. I mean, like probably 10, 15 different people.
It was an older crowd. It's people that are fooled or otherwise drawn in by a website. Making a fake website about a candidate is a very 2007 thing to do.
and not a good one at that.
Pretty gauche, yeah.
And not a good one at that. So, but anyway. All right. The Dave Allen Show on 580 Live is presented in part by Brightway Insurance, the Mays agency of Taze Valley, locally owned and operated by an Air Force veteran and a former teacher. When it comes to insurance, they are everything you've been looking for. Brightway offers expertise from real local agents, real local, not a 1-800 number. Call John or Sherry today, 304-814-2509. Back with more and Rob Cornelius after this on The Voice of Charleston, WCHS.
Brought to you by the Eric J. Tarr Family Businesses. Eric J. Tarr Family Businesses want to thank you for shopping locally.
Owning a home comes with responsibilities. The Kanawha County Sheriff's Office wants to remind you of a very important date. As of April 1st, unpaid 2023 taxes are considered delinquent. If you haven't paid your taxes by now, you have until May 1st to avoid publication. Remember, after April 1st, you cannot pay the half-year fee. You must pay the full year amount. Again, May 1st is the deadline to avoid publication. Visit kanawhasheriff.us to learn more about paying your 2023 taxes.
Unsure you're ready for retirement? That's understandable. After all, you only retire once. Make the smart choice and call 4th Avenue Financial. If it deals with retirement planning, you can be confident they have the experience you need. Retire right with 4th Avenue Financial. Go to 4thAvenueFinancial.com or call 304-746-7977 to book your free introductory meeting today.
Securities offered through JW Cole Financial Incorporated, member FINRA/SIPC. Advisory services offered through JW Cole Advisors Incorporated, JW Cole Financial, JW Cole Advisors, and 4th Avenue Financial are unaffiliated entities.
Are you looking for a powerful, luxurious, and innovative truck? Hey, it's Sydney, inviting you to find new roads with Thornhill and check out the new 2024 Chevrolet Silverado 1500 Crew Cab LTZ and High Country at Thornhill GM Superstore on the Thornhill Motor Mile. Right now, you can get 1.9% APR for well-qualified buyers or $5,000 total value when you trade in an eligible vehicle. It's an opportunity to save big on the new Chevy truck that'll haul the winter blues away. Find new roads to Thornhill GM Superstore. Click or come by at thornhillgmsuperstore.com or on the road to total savings. US 119 Chapmanville. All offers through GM Financial. See Thornhill for all details.
Six away from 10, Dave Allen Show and 580 Live, brought to you part by Live Healthy West Virginia, presented by WVU Medicine. Live Healthy West Virginia tackles pressing health issues like heart disease, diabetes, Alzheimer's, and RSV. It's a podcast offering insights into medical breakthroughs and preventative care, featuring WVU Medicine's expert physicians, aimed at fostering healthier lifestyles in and beyond West Virginia. It's a valuable resource for all. Discover the latest episodes on WVMetroNews.com under the podcast menu and start your journey towards better health today. Phone calls to the show with service of Biggly Piggly Wiggly, texting service provided by Fruith Pharmacy. Tech says, Dave, the one and only reason that candidate's sexuality is a factor is due to their history of supporting anti-LGBTQ legislation. Two-faced behavior, says the texter.
I don't know what candidate they're talking about. So,
there you go.
How would I know?
All right. Let's go national for a moment.
Please.
It's Trump v. Biden, a matchup that a whole lot of Americans don't want and have said that they don't want. But here we are. Your take.
You can't always get what you want is the more popular lyric. Look, it's a choice you have, and the choice is going to come down to do you want a guy who appears to be mostly incompetent, under whom the country's economy is terrible, or someone who says some awesome things sometimes on Twitter, but you were able to afford gas and you didn't have inflation and, you know, Iran wasn't a problem and Israel wasn't getting invaded and raped and all these things. Like, things seem more stable everywhere but Twitter when Trump was president. Think about it.
I mean, this is the best we can do, Rob.
I didn't say it was the best we could do. I would trend younger on both, but that's beyond our choice.
I find it so interesting.
And our primary is late and irrelevant anyway. No one's going to show up.
That's true, and it's all over. And one of these two is going to be the next president of the United States. But I just find it very interesting that they go after Biden, who I am not a fan of by any stretch of the imagination. They go after Biden on being frail and being weak, of which he is. Have you heard Trump speak lately? Have you seen Trump walk lately?
His walking's really good.
His walk is not good. He can barely stand. They're both pathetic old men, Rob. Damn it, we can do better.
But you know, we're beyond that stage, and the voters want Trump, and I don't blame them, because you know why they want Trump? The story is interesting. Voters want to be entertained more than anything. Whether they like him or they hate him, they're going to keep watching. I've said this to you before, that scene in the Howard Stern movie, the people who like Stern listen for an hour, people who hate Stern listen for 3 hours.
That's true. That was the Rush Limbaugh effect.
And that is exactly it. And Limbaugh was brilliant.
He was.
Dude, monologue for 3 hours. No, virtually no callers, none of this stupid texting, all you.
Hey, he's on the stupid text, man, because I've got stupid text right now. No, they're not stupid.
They're stacking.
I'm kidding. They're not stupid. Text said, did Cornelius really name drop a gay billionaire as proof that Republicans welcome LGBTQ? How about you name a regular person, says a texter. I would rather you didn't, if it's a good one to talk about.
Yeah, probably not, but I mean, did you guys realize how many gay dudes you've elected from both parties to this state capitol over the last 20 or 30 years?
Do you realize how many are there now?
That too.
Yeah. That just don't talk about it?
It's not very interesting, honestly.
Texas Republicans and conservatives think being gay is something to be ashamed of, yet they run to vote for someone who's admitted to have non-consensual relations and friendships with a sex trafficker. I think Republicans and conservatives need to have a talk with Jesus. Texas says, Dave, don't let him lie about the economy. Ask about unemployment, wage growth, stock market, etc.
Our God is an awesome God, and the stock market's propped up by a ton of inflation.
Dave, fact check your guess. The economy is better today than it's been since the 1980s.
These are what I believe Rush would term seminar texters. And you guys, you and Hoppy, like, sift through these all day. Like, I don't think we have paid people on my side that do this. They're unpaid. There's plenty of volunteer, but, like, this is very much the paid texters. They bore me.
They're paid? My texters are paid?
I'm assuming that, yeah.
Who are they paid by?
I don't know. Soros.
Soros. Blame George Soros. And so everything that in the world of politics that goes bad, it's either Soros or it's the Koch brothers. You know, you can throw out.
Sure.
Text Cornelius, Republicans want Trump because he's a shiny object, and Republicans like shiny objects. Close with
that. Well, that's what I just said. I mean, period. We want to be entertained. He's entertaining to people. People want to see what he does next, just like me sometimes.
Yes, well, I do.
What are you going to do? I don't know. It'll be entertaining. Someone may poop on coats. Who knows?
Well, coming up on the show tomorrow, Dr. Casey Sachs from Bridge Valley, who will not poop on coats,
I promise. I've heard very good things about her.
She'll be on the show tomorrow talking about Bridge Valley. Also, Greg Thomas will be on the show tomorrow.
Dueling banjos. I'm not having lunch with him today, but we'll plan something.
I would love to have you and Greg together on the show.
We're a great time.
Yeah.
He's like my meaner.